bow down prostrate. You are the only one worthy of praise. I stand before you with an attentive heart.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to another episode of How to Protect Yourselves and Your Family from the Shaitan. In this episode, inshallah ta'ala, we're looking at another weapon that we have available to us against the Shaitan and against the plots of the Shaitan. And in reality, this is the greatest weapon. There is nothing greater than this weapon in fighting against the Shaitan. There is nothing that will protect you and your family more from the Shaitan than this. In fact, this is the single greatest thing that a Muslim has to protect them from anything negative happening to them in this world or in the next. And this weapon is Tawheed. What is Tawheed? Tawheed in Arabic, it comes from the verb wahada, yuwahid. And it means to make something one, or to unify something, or to believe or to declare that something is one. For a Muslim, the word Tawheed means that you dedicate all of your worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, and that you don't worship anyone or anything besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the greatest form of protection. This is the one thing which protects a Muslim from the evils of this world and the next. As a simple evidence for this, before we even talk about the virtues of worshipping Allah alone and the need of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, consider this. Every single dua, every single remembrance, every single dhikr that relates to protecting you and your family from the shaitan, the essence of it is this. The essence of it is the worship of Allah alone. Your declaration that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone deserves to be worshipped. How many times does La ilaha illallah come mentioned in du'as to protect you from the shaitan? Like saying 10 times in the morning and in the evening. La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika la, lahul mulk wa lahul hamd, yuhyi wa yumit, wa huwa ala kulli shay'in qadir. 10 times in the morning and the evening. La ilaha illallah, there is no God worthy of worship except Allah, alone and with no partner. All praise, the dominion and praise is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, with no partner. He gives life and He causes death, and He is able to do all things. This dua protects you in the morning and in the evening. What is there in there that protects you? Tawheed. The fact that you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. The fact that you don't make a partner with Allah azza wa jal. The very first thing that every single prophet was sent, and the thing that was given the single most amount of importance, the worship of Allah alone. The very reason that we say La ilaha illallah again and again and again. When we read Surah Al-Fatiha, when we read Ayatul Kursi, when we read Qul Hu Allahu Ahad, Qul A'udhu Bi Rabbil Falaq, Qul A'udhu Bi Rabbin Nas. When we do these things to protect us and our families, the very essence of them, the secret of them is Tawheed. Is that they contain the affirmation and the declaration that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deserves to be worshipped, and that nothing deserves to be worshipped besides Allah azza wa jal. This is the very fundamental of your religion. What's the very first thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught his people? Very, very, very first thing. The very beginning, before everything and anything else. My people, say La ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah. That nothing deserves to be worshipped except Allah. Nothing deserves to be worshipped except Allah. We've already covered in a previous episode about the history of the people of Quraysh, about what they used to do, about the idol worship they used to have, about the fact that they used to say what they used to say regarding their idols, that we only worship them to make us near to Allah. These idols are our intercessors with Allah. We've heard all of this. Now let's look at this from the point of view as a weapon that we use against the shaitan. The greatest thing the shaitan fears, and the thing the shaitan knows is going to ruin all of his plans, is for you to be from the people who worship Allah Azza wa Jal alone. And we said the very greatest trap of the shaitan is shirk. to try to turn you away from Islam, to try to get you to make a partner with Allah, then surely the greatest weapon against this is for you to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. For those of you who have been involved in ruqya, in treating people who are afflicted by the shayateen, in helping people who have been afflicted by the magic that we talked about in a previous episode, you will know that the one thing that you carry with you as a shield against the shaitan is La ilaha illallah. And that La ilaha illallah can destroy the plots of the shaitan because of what it means, because of what it means. And not just a word that you say on your tongue. And this really is the problem. For many people, their tawheed is a blunt weapon against the shaitan. Because whenever they try to use it, it's not really there. It's just lip service. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. It's just something people say. It's only when you start to live la ilaha illallah, when you start to practice la ilaha illallah, when you make la ilaha illallah the beginning of your day and the middle of your day and the end of your day, the whole of your day is built around it. And your work is built around it. And your da'wah is built around it. Your calling people to Islam is built around it. Then you will see the virtue of these words, la ilaha illallah. La ilaha illallah has conditions that have to be fulfilled. Has conditions that have to be fulfilled. And a poet gathered all of these conditions together in a line of poetry. He said, Al-ilmu wal-yaqeenu wal-qabulu wal-inqiyadu fadri ma aqulu wal-sidqu wal-ikhlasu wal-mahabba waffaqaqa Allahu lima ahabba. Seven conditions. The first, knowledge. You have to know what it means to say La ilaha illallah. You have to know what La ilaha illallah really means for me and for you. Not just words that we say, but you understand what it means. And that's why if you met a non-Muslim in the street, you stopped them on the edge of the road and you said to them, repeat after me, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. So that non-Muslim says, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. Say, congratulations, you've become a Muslim. Say, what? I didn't know I was becoming a Muslim. They didn't become a Muslim. Because they didn't understand what you were asking them to say. They didn't understand what it entails. They didn't have any of the conditions of La ilaha illallah. The very first thing you have to understand it. You teach your children La ilaha illallah. Sometimes the very first word a child says, they will teach him to say Allah, Allah. La ilaha illallah. By the time the child is 1.5, 2 years old, they're saying La ilaha illallah, copying their mom and dad. But how long do we wait until we teach our children what it means to say La ilaha illallah? Briefly, let's talk about it, you and I together. La ilaha illallah is made up of two parts. La ilaha illallah. La ilaha on one side, illallah on the other. And al ilah, the word ilah, is anything which is worshipped. That's why Allah Azza wa Jal says, وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ آلِهَةً. They took, besides Allah, ilah, aliha, the plural of ilah, something which is worshipped. And Allah Azza wa Jal says in the Quran, alihatan yu'badun, an ilah which is worshipped. So it's very, very, very clear that the ilah in Arabic is something or someone that is worshipped, rightly or wrongly. Rightly or wrongly. Ilah doesn't mean a creator. Ilah doesn't mean a sustainer. Ilah doesn't mean a provider. Ilah doesn't mean the most merciful. Ilah means something that is worshipped, rightly or wrongly. So the very first thing we say as Muslims is La ilah. There is no thing that is worshipped. But this on its own is not enough, because this on its own is a statement of atheism. There is nothing that is worshipped. No tree, no sun, no stars, no moon, nothing that is worshipped. So we need the second part. Illallah. Accept Allah. La ilaha illallah. There is nothing that is worshipped except Allah. Now the problem with this is up to now, there is nothing that is worshipped except Allah is factually incorrect. Because there are lots of things that are worshipped besides Allah. There are trees that are worshipped besides Allah. There are prophets that are worshipped besides Allah. There are holy people, both living and dead, that are worshipped besides Allah. There are animals that are worshipped besides Allah. There are celestial bodies, the stars, that are worshipped besides Allah. Nature is worshipped besides Allah. Many, many, many things. There are idols that are worshipped besides Allah, stones that are worshipped besides Allah. So if all of these things are worshipped besides Allah, how can we as Muslims say there is nothing that is worshipped except Allah? Well, actually, we need to have a word to put in here in context. And that word is bihaqqin or haqqan. There is nothing that is really worshipped except Allah, or should be worshipped except Allah, or deserves to be worshipped except Allah. So when you say La ilaha illallah, what you're actually saying is, there is nothing deserving of worship except Allah. Yes, there are many other things that are worshipped, but none of them are truly deserving of worship except Allah. So nothing is deserving of prayer except Allah. Nothing is deserving of dua except Allah. Nothing is deserving of any part of your worship to be directed to it other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those two things. That you disbelieve in everything that is worshipped besides Allah. You don't worship Allah and the sun, Allah and the moon, Allah and the idols, because this would make you a polytheist. And you don't reject the worship of everything, including Allah. You stand in the middle. You reject the worship of everything besides Allah, and you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. This is the knowledge of La ilaha illallah that you need to have, and it's one of the seven conditions, the first of the seven conditions. After the break, we're going to look at the other six, insha'Allah ta'ala. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Tawheed is the basis of Islam, submission to God. Character is shaped by faith. Belief in God and righteous conduct can never be separated. Learn how Tawheed builds character with me, Yahya Ibrahim, only on Peace TV.
Visualize the character which uproots darkness and stands firm against every injustice. Join Yahya Ibrahim in Tawheed Builds Character every Wednesday at 4:30 p.m. UK and 5:30 p.m. Europe on Peace TV.
Where truth is hidden, misleading quotations create confusion. Where truth is hidden, lack of knowledge and wisdom cause upheaval and commotion. Where truth is hidden, manipulated scriptures and twisted facts emerge. This very hidden truth creates false propaganda, mayhem, chaos, disorder, and turmoil in our lives and the world order. But is there anyone with courage and wisdom? What is the truth, and who has the courage to expose it? Because it's your right to know the truth.
Watch Truth Prevail and Lies Perish in Truth Exposed by Dr. Zakir Naik tonight at 9 p.m. UK and 10 p.m. Europe on Peace TV.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. In this episode, we're talking about the greatest weapon that anyone has against the shaitan. And that is Tawheed. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone and not to make a partner with Allah azza wa jal. We said that this has conditions. And it's not enough for you just to say La ilaha illallah and then let it go. The first thing is you have to know what it means. It means that you disbelieve in everything that is worshipped besides Allah, regardless of who or what it is, and you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. This is the first thing. After that comes al-yaqeen, certainty. You can't be saying La ilaha illallah as a way to hedge your bets. as a way to simply say that, well, if Allah exists, la ilaha illallah, if He doesn't, I'm not going to lose out. You have to be certain. It has to be said from yaqeen, from certainty in the heart. La ilaha illallah. I'm as certain of this as I am of anything else. La ilaha illallah. So you have to have knowledge. You have to have certainty. Qabul. You have to accept what it entails. You have to accept that la ilaha illallah, you know what it means. And you're certain about it. Well, it entails some things. It actually has some things that it entails, some things that are part of the package. You can't take one part and not the rest. You have to accept that that means that you can't make dua to the dead, that you can't make dua to the idols, that you can't call upon people in the graves, that you can't call upon the stars in the sky, that you can't go to a magician or a fortune teller, that you can't read your horoscopes. It has some things that it entails. You have to accept those things that it entails. You can't just say la ilaha illallah and continue to make dua to the dead. La ilaha illallah and continue to sacrifice to the pious people. La ilaha illallah and continue to do all of these aspects of shirk. You can't do that. When you say la ilaha illallah, you have to take the whole package, everything that it contains. And that means that your life changes. And that's why Quraysh used to say, and used to refuse to say la ilaha illallah, and say, has he made all of our gods into one god? This is something strange. Because they knew that when they said it, it was going to mean that they had to accept that their idols were gone. And that the things they used to worship besides Allah were gone, even if they were prophets, even if they were angels. They all had to go. Because they understood that it has some terms and conditions you have to accept. Well, inqiyad, submission. This is the meaning of the word Islam. The word Islam means al-istislamu lillah. It means that you submit to Allah. The word Islam actually means submission to Allah. That you submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is very, very, very important. So when you say la ilaha illallah, and you believe in la ilaha illallah, and you accept that it means things have to change, you have to go and submit. That means you have to stop doing those things and you have to submit to the laws of Allah, to what Allah made halal and to what Allah made haram. You have to try your very best to do the things that Allah Azza wa Jal made halal and to avoid the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made haram. The very, very, very best of your ability. There has to be some submission. And after that, as-sidq, truthfulness. Have to be truthful in what you say. How many people say la ilaha illallah and they're not truthful? They're not truthful. They say it for the sake of the dunya, for the sake of getting a passport, for the sake of getting a residency visa, for the sake of getting married, for the sake of whatever. But it's not truthful. You have to be truthful in it. It has to be a true statement, not a lie. You truly and genuinely believe it. Well, ikhlas has to be only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only for Allah. Not for your mom and dad so that they can see that you're a good Muslim. Not so that your community can see you're a good Muslim. Not so that your employer can see that you're a good Muslim. Just for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And we talked in a previous episode about how dangerous that matter of shirk is. How dangerous it is. And how dangerous it is for your intention to slip away and for you to have some element of worshipping other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if it just means that you want your reputation or you want people to see you in a good way. La ilaha illallah has to be sincere. And finally, al-mahabba. Your driving force has to be the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That you love Allah azza wa jal more than you love anyone and anything else. And the love you have for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not like the love that you have for anyone else. It's not like the love you have for your mom and dad. It's not like the love you have for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's not like the love that you have for your wife or your husband. This is a pure love that is for Allah azza wa jal, that you have dedicated your life for Allah, that you love what Allah azza wa jal loves and you hate what Allah azza wa jal hates, that you build your allegiances and you show enmity based on the love of Allah, loving those who Allah loves and hating those who Allah Azza wa Jal hates. To the extent that Allah loves them or to the extent that Allah hates them, because it's not a black and white issue. And this is your driving force. Your disbelief in everything that is worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This tawheed, when you bring these conditions, knowledge and certainty and acceptance and submission and truthfulness and sincerity and the love of Allah Azza wa Jal, when you bring these conditions together and you practice them in your life, you will have a protection against the shaitan that will protect you in every single circumstance. More than that, you will have yourself a door and a path to Jannah, the only path to Jannah. There is no other path to Jannah except through Tawheed. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah has made the hellfire forbidden for the one who says La ilaha illallah seeking the face of Allah. If you say La ilaha illallah and you only seek what is with Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the hellfire forbidden for you. There is a beautiful story of the man, and it's called the story of the bitaqa, the story of the man and the piece of paper or the card. This man, he came on the day of judgment and he had 99 scrolls as far as the eye could see. Imagine that. Imagine you come on the day of judgment and you have scrolls as far as the eye can see, full of your evil deeds. He can't even find one good deed. Not even one good deed. Maybe he's wasted them by being bad to other people. He's wasted them by not doing them in accordance with the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For whatever reason he has wasted his deeds, he doesn't find any good deeds. 99 scrolls as far as the eye can see, no good deeds. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says to him, you're not going to be oppressed on this day. He doesn't find anything. Imagine that, as far as the eye can see, 99 scrolls, full of your evil deeds. And then from the inside of his pocket or from the inside of his clothing, he pulls out a piece of paper. And on that piece of paper is written, La ilaha illallah. He says, Oh my Lord, what is this piece of paper going to do against all of these sins? What is this piece of paper going to do? How is this little piece of paper going to outweigh 99 scrolls? And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands for the scale to be established and for them to be weighed. And 99 scrolls, as far as the eye can see, are put on one side of the scale. And La ilaha illallah is put on the other side of the scale. And La ilaha illallah outweighs all of those scrolls. In a hadith, Allah Azza wa Jal is narrated as saying, O my slaves, if you came to me with equal to the world full of sin, the whole world full of sin, and you came to me without having made a partner with you, I would bring you the same amount of forgiveness. If you came to me with the whole world full of sin, the whole earth, every country, every ocean, to the depths of the earth of sins you did, and you came to me not worshipping anything with me, I would come to you with an equal amount of forgiveness. Subhanallah. This is the only thing that will protect you and save you. And all the du'as you make, all of the things that you do, all of the things you learn in this series and in these episodes, all of it comes back to this. If you have it, you will be successful. Your du'as will be answered. You will be protected and your family will be protected. If you don't have it, then there's no hope for you, no matter how much you make du'a, no matter how much you pray, no matter how much you call on Allah Azza wa Jal, until you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. That's why we get rid of the amulets. That's why we fight against the magicians. That's how we fight against the shaitan. The very first thing, the shaitan used to run away from Umar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, O Umar, radiallahu an, O Umar, I see the shaitan fleeing from you. Or when you take a path, the shaitan takes another path. What made the shaitan flee from Umar? The same thing that will make the shaitan flee from you and flee from your family. That belief and that tawheed that only Allah Azza wa Jal deserves to be worshipped. And that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can save you. And that Allah is your mawla. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your protector. Wa ni'man nasir. And the best of helpers. That is what is going to protect you and your children from the shaitan. That is what is going to save you bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. And that is the single most important thing. I'm going to continue in future episodes, inshallah, talking about other weapons that we have against the shaitan. And until then, I leave you in the care of Allah. Jazakumullahu khairan wa barakallahu feekum. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.